This screencast will discuss chemiosmosis, the process of creating ATP during the light-dependent reactions of photosynthesis. Remember that in photosynthesis, our goal is to combine carbon dioxide and water inside the chloroplast of a leaf in order to ultimately generate glucose and oxygen. The light-dependent reactions of photosynthesis occur inside the thylakoid membrane system. With the addition of water and photons of sunlight, we generate oxygen as well as two products, ATP and NADPH. ATP and NADPH ultimately enter the stroma, the other compartment inside the chloroplast, where they're combined with carbon dioxide in order to ultimately generate pGaL, a product that ultimately will become glucose. At this point, this should all be review. Today, we're going to focus on the light-dependent reactions and exactly how it is that they generate ATP and NADPH. Don't forget that the light-independent reactions are actually happening inside of plant cells. Specifically, they occur in the organelle called the chloroplasts. Within the chloroplast itself, the light-dependent reactions occur in something called the thylakoid. So remember, this is happening at a very, very, very small scale. Okay, so now we're going to talk about the light-dependent reactions which occur in the thylakoid. Now, here is my thylakoid, and all of the structures that are embedded in the thylakoid membrane are going to be made of protein. Each one of them has a very specific function in the light-dependent reactions. The entire process is kicked off by a photon of light coming from the sun. An important note about photons. Photons are going to do three separate things during the light-dependent reactions. Number one, activate PS2. Number two, activate PS1. And number three, they're going to cause a process called photolysis, where water splits into multiple pieces. We're going to start by talking about number one, where photons activate PS2. My photon of light, after traveling 93 million miles from the sun to the plant cell, is going to make contact with PS2. PS2 is full of pigments called chlorophyll, including a specific pigment called P680, which absorbs sunlight of the wavelength 680 nanometers. The photon contains a significant amount of energy, which will then excite all of the pigments in photosystem 2. You'll notice that I've left the last pigment molecule uncolored and that there's a small orange dot next to it. This small orange dot represents an electron, which right now is in its low energy state. Once all of the pigments have been activated by the photon, the electron will cease to be a low energy electron and then will become a high energy electron. Now this electron has more energy than it normally has. The electron now has so much energy that it will bounce down through a series of chemical reactions, which we call the electron transport chain. During every step in the electron transport chain, energy is lost from the electron. The electron has now reached the end of the electron transport chain and is now a boring, low-energy electron once again. In addition, photosystem 2 is now missing an electron. This electron will need to be replaced in order to continue photosynthesis. So now we need to ask ourselves, what do we do with all of the energy that was released during the electron transport chain? All of the energy from the electron transport chain will be used in order to power something called a proton pump. The proton pump is activated by the harnessed energy from the electron transport chain. Outside of the thylakoid membrane, out in the stroma, there are many protons, aka H+ ions, floating around. There are also a lot of protons floating around inside the thylakoid membrane. Now, most of the time, this would mean that the protons would want to get out of the cell membrane, and they do. But the proton pump is going to cause protons to flow into the cell membrane. So, kind of like this. This makes the concentration gradient even stronger than it was before, rather than making it weaker like it normally would.
After the proton pump has done its work powered by the electron transport chain, there are now more protons on the inside of the thylakoid than there are on the outside in the stroma. We aren't finished with this tiny electron, however. We aren't done with this low-energy electron, however. It still has more work to do. While the proton pump is working hard next door, the low-energy electron is carried over to PS1. And this is where we can see the second part of a photon's job. The photon will re-energize the electrons in photosystem 1. The electron will be transformed back into its excited state and will then enter the electron transport chain again. Notice that in photosystem 1 there is a different pigment being used. In photosystem 1 we use P700 instead of P680. The high-energy electron will bounce through the electron transport chain just like it did in the previous slides. Just as it did previously, it will release energy with every step of the electron transport chain and end up a low-energy electron. This time, all of the energy from the second electron transport chain will be used to do something different. This time, the energy from the electron transport chain will be used to combine something called NADP plus two electrons and a hydrogen ion in order to form NADPH. Now we've made one of the two major products of the light-dependent reactions, NADPH, which is going to become very important as we move into the light-independent reactions. Just to make sure we're on the same page, here's what we've done so far. A photon of light is activated PS2 and triggered the chlorophyll particles inside it. This causes the release of a high-energy electron, whose energy bouncing down the electron transport chain is used to power a proton pump, which brings in hydrogen ions from the stroma into the thylakoid. While that's happening, another photon is activating PS1, which causes energy to be released as a high-energy electron bounces down the electron transport chain. We harness that energy in order to combine NADP+, two electrons, a hydrogen ion, in order to form NADPH. However, we have a small problem with this. If we go back to PS2, we still have a missing electron, which needs to be replaced if the cycle is going to continue. In order to replace this missing electron, we're going to take a look at the third task of a photon, which is to split water in a process called photolysis. If we look inside of the thylakoid, we'll see that the thylakoid already has some water in it. When struck by a photon, water will split into three components. It will split into protons, a molecule of oxygen, as well as three low-energy electrons. One of these three electrons will go on to replace the electron that was lost in PS2. So now we no longer have a missing electron in PS2, and now we have two electrons remaining from photolysis. The remaining two electrons from photolysis will transfer over to the end of PS1, where they will become two electrons necessary in order to form NADPH from NADP+. So now we have even more protons on the inside of the thylakoid, and we also have a handy waste product, oxygen. The oxygen will diffuse out of the leaf through the stomata. This oxygen, the waste product of photolysis, is the oxygen that we breathe. So far, we've now created two of the major products of photosynthesis. We've created oxygen, and then we've also created the intermediate product, NADPH. But we still need to create ATP, and that's going to use a protein called ATP synthase, which you can see here in orange at the bottom of the screen. Thanks to the work of the proton pumps and the products of photolysis, there are a lot of protons inside the thylakoid. If you look at the number of protons on the upper half of the screen versus on the lower half, it's pretty easy to see that there's a concentration gradient between the upper half and the lower half. The protons want to move from the crowded upper half of the screen in order to get onto the lower half of the screen that is less crowded. However, the only way to get out of the thylakoid is through the ATP synthase protein. So, protons will move through the ATP synthase like this, in order to get onto the less crowded side of the membrane. Every time a proton passes through, ATP synthase will combine a molecule called ADP, which has very little potential energy, with inorganic phosphate. When you combine ADP with inorganic phosphate, you get ATP, which is a lot of potential energy. And ATP is the other intermediate product of the light-dependent reactions in photosynthesis. So we've covered a lot of material on this screencast so far, so let's make sure that we're all on the same page. The light-dependent reactions are the first half of photosynthesis, and our goal is to create two products, ATP and NADPH, and along the way we'll create oxygen as a waste product. The entire process is triggered by photons of light, and photons do three things. They activate PS2, they activate PS1, and they also split water in a process called photolysis. As a result of PS1, we have multiple bouts of energy that are released from a high-energy electron, which allows the proton pump to bring protons from the stroma into the thylakoid membrane. In PS2, the photosystem is activated by another photon, which also causes a release of energy through an electron transport chain. This electron transport chain is harnessed in order to make a product called NADPH. Finally, the results of the proton pump's work is a large concentration gradient between the thylakoids inside and the stroma on the outside. The only way for the protons to exit the thylakoid membrane and travel down the concentration gradient is through ATP synthase. Every time protons pass through it, it provides the potential to create a molecule of ATP out of ADP and inorganic phosphate. Our two products, NADPH and ATP, are now ready to travel into the stroma where they can be used in the light-independent reactions.